like a final declaration. So, and I think the Earth is like covered with that kind of stuff. Like, even
what kind of, what kind of stuff? I just so I understand what you mean by that.
Okay, well, even the oceans, like the oceans are like so big and deep. Oceans kind of like frighten me in so far as that they're like so big and so deep. It's like, oh my goodness, that's a little spooky. I remember when I was a kid and I saw like The Perfect Storm, the film with George Clooney and Mark Wahlberg and all that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
But that was like a spooky, and you know, I like Alien and Shining and all that kind of stuff, but The Perfect Storm was a frightening film. And the thing is that, like, I think human beings, especially, here's the thing, and this will be perfect for the Coast audience, is even if you're into virtual reality or not into virtual reality, the thing is that, like, I imagine the Coast audience is, like, very much curious about UFOs and USOs and that kind of situation. And it kind of seems like they might be at the bottom of the ocean, I think, because one of the curious things about that situation, and then I'll shut up and hear feedback, but there was this wonderful guy, his name was Mac Tonis, and he wrote this book called Crypto-Terrestrial, and he thought that they all live, all the UFOs and all the aliens live at the bottom of the ocean, and it doesn't really matter whether or not that's true. The fact is there's so much traffic of the UFO character, and I live in like the Hudson River Valley area, so they're rather frequent, but it's very hard. And like, how does that like go into VR? Like, I kind of think that like VR, religious experiences, spiritual experiences, they're just there to really kind of activate consciousness. They really, like, make you go outside yourself.
But that's a good thing, right? I mean, if you're saying that VR and augmented reality and a lot of these other technological platforms get you outside of yourself, isn't that the goal of so much of what we would explain to our kids, is to get outside of your life so you're not just staring down at a screen? Get outside of your life, find new things to be interested in, and not to settle for only that which we can see with our eyes in front of us, but that it can spark the imagination. You mentioned earlier about travel, because I was talking about VR in that context, and I just think of VR as another version of the stereoscopes that I had on our, you know, coffee table growing up. My mother was into collecting these old 3D like images from the early from the national parks. So funny you should mention something like the Grand Canyon and stuff. That's exactly what we had. We had all of these different 3D images of the West, and I think, well, that stereo, those stereoscopes, that stereoscopy or whatever they called it, that science is really not a whole lot different from what we're doing with VR. It was shocking to people that they were able to see something in such detail, and they could suddenly now imagine themselves being in it or going to it. And I think of that as a positive thing. What's the, for you, what would be the biggest downside of even then the old stereoscopes? Because if I'm right and that's part of the same thread, what was wrong with those? Or those like little Kenner things that I used to grow up with, where you put them up to your eyes and you flip through different pictures on a, you know, a viewfinder?
It's totally part of the same thread, and I don't knock it. The thing is that, like, I look at virtual reality as very much like a metaphor or a concept to help us understand where we are in the universe physically, right, socially, psychologically, that kind of thing. And I don't knock it. I don't knock it down. Like, it's all very, very, very... It has its uses. It has its value. But we can't just give up on... We cannot just stop the show.
Okay, you lost me there a little bit. Because earlier you said that you are against it. You think it's all bad. And now I don't know what you mean when you say we can't just stop the show. What show are we talking about when you say...
Well, what we're talking about is, like, the human story. Like, the human story... The human story can only be a virtual reality, which is what makes it, like, rather interesting. Because, like, imagine you were a fish. Imagine you were a dog. Imagine you were a dolphin. Like, it's always going to be a human story. There's, like, no way out of the human story. It's impossible to, like, get out of it.
Right.
It's like, and the thing is that, like, my entire work has been about, like, there's no way out of the human story, which sounds like an obvious idea, but not a lot of people have really explored it as an actual fundamental reality. Like, it's very hard to conjure with, like, oh man, I'm stuck being a Homo sapien. That's a terrible thing. As opposed to, like, not a terrible thing, but that's a condition. Like, I can't be a cat, I can't be a familiaris, I can't be a dog, I can't be anything, I can't be an octopus, you know, this octopus movie just won an Oscar, my Oscar, my life, so compelling. But I think the big thing is that like what human beings should really do is that like human beings really need to examine the human condition, figure out what's going on there, and largely look at virtual reality, because that's what created human consciousness, sadly, or maybe as a positive.
Well, you know, I'm not sure how it ends the human story. And I, any more than say, like, there are some cultures that would say, you can't photograph me because you're capture part of my soul, my very being, then you own part of it. And other people would say, well, we don't ever want pictures of God. You can't ever imagine in a painting, you know, this, and you get, you know, you could get killed in certain cultures for something like that. Before I get to the bottom of there, give me 60 seconds on what you would do about it. If you were in charge, in some virtual reality, would you stop it? Would you make a law against it where nobody could? Well, then help me. What would you do?
I would rather see, like, how the players play out. It would teach me more. It would help me learn more. Like, I'm not into telling people or entities or agents what to do. I'm far more interested in seeing how they react and behave and stuff. I'm loving this conversation, by the way.
Good. Well, I gotta get to the bottom of the hour here, and then we'll give the numbers so that you can join the conversation. Coming up, we'll do open lines too on the way. Stand by. And when I say we do open lines, we take it any direction you want to go. And one place I want to go immediately is to tomorrow night. Mary Roach is our main guest. She's the author of the book about policing wildlife. It's called Fuzz. And if you've ever heard her on Coast to Coast, you know this is going to be a majorly fun night. And first hour, two different looks at crashes in the desert of you-know-who.
or don't you, next on Coast to Coast AM. This is Ian Punnett.
KFI, news on the hour, on the half, and when it breaks.
I'm Brian Berubin from the KFI 24-hour newsroom. Two of Governor Newsom's kids have tested positive for COVID-19. The governor's office says the kids have mild symptoms and they are in quarantine. Newsom, his wife, and his other two children have tested negative. People listened when Hawaii said to stay away, and now the locals are suffering.
Officials in Hawaii say business is down about 30% compared to just before the governor's request that people stay away. Since Governor Ige's request on August 23rd, hotels are seeing cancellations every day, with future bookings slowing as well. Hotel occupancy was mostly between 75 and 80% over the summer, but it's now dropped below 50 and 40%. A union repping hospitality worker says fewer tourists and daily room cleaning done away with means less work for people. Governor Ige does say COVID-19 cases are going down, and there won't be another shutdown in the state because of the high vaccination rate in the state. Michael Crozier, KFI News.
SoCal weather from KFI, lows in the mid-50s to low 60s at the beaches, upper 60s to upper 70s in metro LA and OC. Wee Lee Local from the KFI 24-hour newsroom. I'm Brian Berumen.
Crashing Downey on the southbound side of the 5 at Paramount Boulevard has all lanes stopped. The moment you're jammed back to Garfield. We also have all lanes still shut down in San Juan Capistrano on the southbound side of the 5 Ortega Highway to Camino Capistrano. This is a crashing overturn. Big rig and a diesel still. And you're slow starting around Junipero Serra Road. Still more on the eastbound side of the 210 between the 5 and Rockford. Caltrans has all lanes shut down until around 6 a.m. And all lanes closed westbound side of the 10 into Santa Monica, 4th Street to the McClure Tunnel, so 6. KFI in the sky helps get there faster. I'm Robert Kibucki.
We've all heard that you've got the right to remain silent, but have you ever really thought about what that means? It's the police literally telling you to shut up. I'm attorney Darren Cavanocchi from 1-800-NO-CUFFS. If you're in custody and everything you say can and definitely will be used against you, remain silent and just shut up. Just make your one phone call to 1-800-NO-CUFFS, the leader in criminal defense. 1-800-NO-CUFFS, because no one looks good in handcuffs, unless you're into that sort of thing. 1-800-NO-CUFFS.
The Delta variant is making COVID-19 spread faster and more easily. Variants can be more contagious, aggressive, and deadly. But we know vaccines work. Vaccinated Californians have greater protection against serious illness, hospitalization, and death. We can help stop the spread and end this pandemic. Get vaccinated and wear a mask when it can protect you and others. Find a vaccine near you at myturn.ca.gov. Brought to you by the California Department of Public Health.
Whoa, deja vu, totally. Trout is back, bros and broettes. The good news is SoCal locals know how to stay chill. We can ride this out by cutting back on our water use. It's second nature, part of the twists and turns of living here. So let's revisit shorter showers with a buddy bucket nearby to catch wasted water. Spend less time watering lawns, or even better, replace some grass with California-friendly native plants. For water-saving tips and rebates, visit BeWaterWise.com.
With record low interest rates, is it still wise to pay off your home, or has it become unwise? Wall Street says money never sleeps. Well, your home equity is in a coma. It's earning zero. Record low interest rates have created enormous opportunity for homeowners to borrow equity and move into alternative investments. It may have made a lot of sense when interest rates were 6 or 8% to make it your highest priority to pay your home off. But with these record low rates, it's no longer wise. It's a timeless understanding that buying low and selling high is the way to gain wealth. How about borrowing low and investing in higher returns? Call HMS Capital today. With their razor-sharp interest rates, they're confident they're going to earn your business. No appraisal fee, no application fee. So phone them up right away. 833-255-5698. 833-255-5698. That's 833-255-5698. Or visit HMSCapital.com.
HMS Capital Funding is a DBA of Golden Empire, Inc. NMLS ID number 2427. HMS Capital is licensed under the Department of Financial Protection and Innovation. Under the California Residential Mortgage Lending Act. License number 0130360. Equal housing lender.
The biggest stars from all genres of music will share one stage at our 2021 iHeartRadio Music Festival.
Here from T-Mobile Arena in Las Vegas.
Two nights of performances you've never seen before. Streaming free on a CW app and CWTV.com. And listen on iHeartRadio. Continuing tonight, starting at 7 p.m.
Capital One is the proud partner of the 2021 iHeartRadio Music Festival, bringing great products, rewards, and services to their customers. What's in your wallet?
KFI, AM 640, more stimulating talk. To Ian Ponitt, call the wildcard line at 818-501-4109. The first time caller line is 818-501-4721. To talk toll free from east of the Rockies, call 800-825-5033. From west of the Rockies toll free, call 800-618-8255. This is Coast to Coast AM with Ian Ponitt.
Well, we're experiencing some difficulties with that cellular phone connection. It went back to it. It was gone. So we'll just go ahead and move into open lines, and we'll take open lines. We're going to go to it at the top of the hour anyway, so we'll just jump into it a little bit earlier. Here's how it's going to work, because I need Tom here for a second or two, and then he'll go and answer the phones if you're going to bring
him. Yeah, we'll rack up some calls.
I know you will. And I know that when we talk about paranormal day, you all are really good about keeping track of the numbers. And that's what I've loved, the very overwhelming. What are the sheer volume of people who are part of paranormal day, which just means there's got to be somebody out there for everybody out of that group.
There is. And you know what? It's funny. I was going to ask you real quick. I don't know if I asked you this or not before. You real quick, where did you meet your wife and how did your first date go?
We met, honest to God truth, we met in college at the college newspaper.
Yeah.
No, but people aren't going to believe this, so that's why I preface it. I met her and I proposed to her in the same sentence.
Really? That's the best.
I met her and we were just sitting around a table. We were all at the Daily Illini in Champaign-Urbana at the University of Illinois, and we were just introducing ourselves and what we want to do, and my wife said, I want to be the first female president. And I looked at her and I said, marry me.
I will make
a great first man. I will be there for you forever. I just loved the ambition of that. It took her about 7 months to dump the guy she was with. I swear to God. And all along the way, we were just friendly and having conversations, but I kept reminding her. I said, I'm going to marry you, you know.
I need to applaud that. And that is great.
7 months later, she broke up with him, called me. We were engaged in 3 weeks. We were married about 8 months after that.
Well, I've never had the pleasure of meeting your wife. I'm sure she's a lovely lady.
Yes.
You know, the reason we created a paranormaldate.com is because we want people to be able to go on dates and be like-minded, meet like-minded people and talk about things. And now, there's people out there we realize that are looking for people that are 60-plus. If you're looking for, a little bit older person. So we've created paranormaldate.com/seniors, so you can also go there and find people a bit more mature. So there's two outlets to go and really meet some cool people. And, people are flocking there.
I love that, and that now includes me in the mature category. Not sure my wife would agree with that, but I certainly do.
Only as young as you feel. How what age do you feel, really?
Oh, every day. It depends how fast I'm moving. So I'm working out a lot, and I feel 80. When I'm not, within 2 hours after working out, I feel at least 54. That's about as good as it gets these days. Find out more at coasttocoastam.com. And your open line calls next for the rest of the night on Coast to Coast AM.
This year, to mark 20 years since 9/11, the Tunnel to Towers Foundation is giving 200 mortgage-free homes to Gold Star and fallen first responder families with young children and catastrophically injured veterans and first responders. The foundation's chairman and CEO walked for the month of August through to September 11th from the Pentagon to Shanksville, Pennsylvania, and on to Ground Zero. The foundation brought back towers of light to the memorials at the Pentagon and in Shanksville, read the names aloud of all we lost to 9/11 related illness, and on Veterans Day, in a first for our country, the foundation is having a ceremony to read aloud the names of service members we lost in the War on Terror. help this nation to never forget its greatest heroes. Do good in their honor. Donate $11 a month to Tunnel to Towers at t2t.org. That's T, the number 2, T, dot org.
Sometimes the world can seem a cold place, so we gotta bring the warmth to it. Sometimes the world can seem a broken place, so we gotta strive to fix it. At the end of the day, we are empowered to create the world we want to live in. So we prepare for the worst, but we must always, always expect the best. Smith & Wesson, empowering Americans.
New surveys show that Americans don't think vaccines are enough to protect themselves and others from COVID-19. 80% want thermometers used in public places to screen for COVID-19. 36% know that non-contact devices are inaccurate. And 60% would not recommend that friends or family members enter places that screen with them. To be safe, use Exergen at home, at work, and in public. It's the only thermometer proven accurate by more than 100 published clinical studies. Learn more at Exergen.com.
We went to the call. We couldn't get our guests back, so we're going a little bit earlier for open lines, but that doesn't mean you can't comment on virtual reality or augmented reality or any of your experiences with that. You can certainly share or take us in a completely different direction. That is the nature of open lines. We are, by definition, open to wherever you're going to take us. West of the Rockies, Eric is in Colorado on Coast to Coast AM. Eric?
Hi, thanks for taking my call.
Yeah, thanks for getting us started.
Yeah, so about your conversation with the previous guest, I kind of just have a feeling that, and it seemed like the sort of what you guys were touching on was the kind of whether or not virtual reality could be spiritually beneficial to humankind, whether or not that's whether it could be spiritually beneficial or whether it could possibly be a negative spiritually, you know?
Yeah, what do you think? Where are you with that?
I tend to think that it's a negative, and I think that, like, if whether or not you think that it's spiritually beneficial or not, it could be an indicator of whether you're a materialist or not.
That's interesting. Why would you categorize people who want to expand their realities as being materialists? That would seem to be counterintuitive.
Well, I'm not speaking materialist in the sense of, like, money.
No, I mean even just the idea of a substantive, like the substance of material, of our reality. If you're trying to think outside of that, and you're trying to put a new spin on that, wouldn't that necessarily force a kind of disassociation with the material world?
Well, I'm again speaking spiritually.
Sure, me too.
From a spiritual standpoint. Just that the idea of materialism kind of is that consciousness is a construct of biology and our human bodies and nothing more, and that spirituality would be the same, spirituality would be kind of just relegated to the realm of psychology, sort of, whether, you know, someone was feeling well or enjoying their life or, you know, helping other people and being a good part of society, all good things, but nothing beyond that, you know? So the idea that if someone thinks that virtual reality could be spiritually beneficial to someone, I think that kind of leans into the idea that there isn't anything beyond our own perception of things, you know?
Let me challenge you this way, and let me just say, I think you present the position cogently, and I'm not coming after you at all when I say that in the history of spirituality, sensory perception has always played a part. Music provides an elevation to the senses. Incense plays a very important role in our understanding of our place and time. Immersion, physical immersion, like baptism as an adult, marks a certain stage in our spirituality through a physical experience. I could go on. So if there's always a connection,
but those,
at least in some ways, we kind of ritualize spirituality through physical experiences, don't we?
Yeah, but those are all things that take place in a world, in the natural world. All those things take place in the natural world, and if you believe in God, in the created natural world.
Right.
You know, so I think a lot of people have a sense, and maybe myself included, that there is something more, you know, real or more spiritual in those things, and more beneficial in those things because they were created. They were created.
But there's a lot of other people. There's a lot of other people who would say that that's contrary to true spirituality, and they would say the smells and bells of church, right, as we tend to categorize them, that when we do a service, all the smells and bells, a lot of people reject that, and they want a very stoic experience. It's just the word. It's just what they hear. It's just what they say. They don't sing. They don't sing. And so, well, I guess what I'm saying is I look at all of that as sort of a spectrum, not a line that says these people over here are, you know, too grounded in a material world, and that this is just an extension of that by doing a virtual reality experience. I mean, I don't smoke peyote or eat it or whatever you're supposed to do. I don't do LSD, obviously. I don't even know that quite how off I am in the way I'm describing some of these things. But I mean, I understand why some people need to do that in order to break through the reality that they were born with or raised with in order to try to understand a perception beyond what they've experienced. Are you against that?
No, I'm not against it, but I'm being kind of black and white here, but I think that comes down again to whether or not you're talking about something that's psychologically beneficial, solely and relegated to the realm of, you know, sort of a secular way of looking at things, or the alternative of there being some kind of mysterious other force at work there. And I guess you come to think of it, you know, maybe you can't say that force couldn't work through virtual reality, though.
That's what I said. I think that's really what it comes down to, is I wouldn't tell, if the divine being is all ineffable and all, then we can't define it, we can't control it. It could work through Star Trek, it could work through being hit by a car, it could work through a bad dream, it could work through a lot of things, and we could have a breakthrough experience when we least expect it. But I cannot tell you how much I respect your position on this, and that you got us back on track, and I'm grateful for that. So thank you, Eric. Wildcard line, Bob is in Oregon on Coast to Coast AM. Hey, Bob.
Hi, thanks for taking my call. Okay, so I have a pretty wild story for you. My nephew was practicing his Tridentine Catholic faith till he was 18 years old, and then my sister let him emancipate himself. And so he stopped going to...
Legally speaking?
Pardon me?
Legally speaking?
Well, just in the way of giving him the choice of whatever, not having to practice his Catholic religion.
Thank you. I understand better. You're just saying at 18, she took the reins off.
Basically, yeah. And so what he did was he went into the virtual reality world. And so I completely agree with Elliot Edge that... Just as he said, there's an addiction to orgasms. This young man is 22 years old. He has an IQ of 148. He only has a permit to drive. He hasn't gone out to get his license because he gets paranoid. But he's got all these ocular and special kind of lenses for his virtual reality. And he goes in there, and in there he thinks he's a SWAT team or special forces guy. And he basically lives in the basement of her home in this virtual reality world. And he has like 23 pairs of pajama pants and two pairs of regular pants, and he's completely lost.
Well, this is an interesting... I think this is interesting. So let me, as a father of men in their 20s, or my oldest son just turned 30, let me make an argument for you, and then you feel free to take it apart. I know lots of guys, when I was growing up, who when they first went to college at 18, in that same sort of emancipated way, stopped going to church, and they started drinking like crazy. And they never recovered. They never recovered. They became alcoholics. They smashed into things. They joined a frat or didn't or whatever, fell off of stuff. There's a long tradition of people whose names I could list, who I'm not just making a straw man argument, people who we would say, if you and I were in a conversation at one point in college, we'd say, so-and-so is wasting their life away. Wasting one's life away doing dumb stuff didn't start with VR. Right?
Right.
So before that it was weed, or it was before that it was alcohol, or it was music. Somebody joins a band and they do nothing but sit and play the guitar in a basement, and they never actually do anything in life. Maybe they get a job later on for 25 hours a week, but they're committed thinking that someday they're going to be a big rock star, and they live in that fantasy. What's the difference? Then
is in the top 10% or 2% of the population in his ability to think.
Yeah. Frequently the people that are the most...
Go ahead. Skills.
I with 100%, but I'll tell you a funny story. And I hope you can appreciate the humor of this. I was talking to a colleague at another university, and she was telling me that there are young men coming to school after COVID, and she said, it's so weird. She said, I've got 18, 19-year-old guys hitting on me in the office. She's an administrative assistant, and they're hitting on me, and they think they've got a shot. And she said, I keep telling them, go away. I've got 10, 15 years on you. And it's sort of like the world is a little upside down these days. I'm with you. I don't know that just because that's his experience at 22, that this is what he's doomed to do for the rest of his life. And remember what Spock always said, which is the more complex the mind, the greater the need for the simplicity of play. And maybe he has gone down a rabbit hole, but he wouldn't be the first.
But it's a form of delayed maturity.
Yeah.
And really has made him socially unacceptable. He doesn't know how to relate to other people. So
right.
Those warnings that Elliot were giving were right on the money. And because it does...
But why isn't that true for girls?
I don't know why.
This is
to regulate themselves a little more. I've been married.
Right. See what I mean? I think this is interesting. Like the whole video game craze. Remember when this was? We were all blaming this, and I'm not trying to make you sound like a get off my lawn kind of guy. But there was a time when we were saying this about video games, and we were saying this about. Then we were saying it about first person shooter games, and then we were saying it before that about comic books and rock and roll and. There's always sort of this moral panic about something new, and then after some while we realize, oh, it actually wasn't R-rated movies or MTV after all. It was just the way this kid was wired, and that's what they became upside down in. Not saying it's right. I'm agreeing with you. What a waste. But I'm also not willing to say that yet that this kid's lost forever, because we've all seen people pull out of that dive, right?
Absolutely, yeah. But this failure to launch, even at I mean, staying in a basement playing these games and these virtual things all the time, I mean, you're living in a fake reality. And
I get that.
It's an addictive thing, just like Elliot said. When do you get enough? When do the orgasms stop?
Okay, can we find a new way? Can we have a new metaphor? I'm going to argue for a new metaphor. I'm going to say that's the last time people can use that metaphor. Okay, and then we're going to move on, because nothing again. I mean, I was getting uncomfortable when he kept repeating it, so I just didn't want to make sure we're doing that for the rest of the night. All right, let me get to Walt in Pennsylvania. He's got a minute here for us on Coast to Coast AM. Walt?
Professor Punnett, it's always great to talk to you, buddy.
And to you. Go ahead, where are you going to take us?
Why, similar to what the first two gentlemen said, well, the other night, George had a professor, I believe his name was Sheldrick, on, and he sort of implied that if you're an atheist, that you're necessarily an amoral, nihilistic sort of boogeyman. And as I told George numerous times, I regard myself as a conservative atheist, as, you know, like a, I like to say, a John Wayne type of atheist. I'm an atheist, but I'm pro-life. I have conservative values, and Ian, I don't have to tell you that, you know, religious brainwashing is a dangerous thing. You know, the situation we have over in the Middle East, obviously can be as brainwashed into the Bible and Hebraic law as the Taliban is to into the brainwashed into the Quran and Sharia law. You know, if you read passages in the Bible like...
every day.
You know, I mentioned to George, Deuteronomy, 22nd Deuteronomy, it says that if a woman doesn't bleed on her wedding night, that she can be stoned to death. Well, obviously, that's just as sexually repressive and misogynistic as Sharia law.
I'm not against... I think your point is totally valid. I don't... It's one of those things about fundamentalism, which always leaves me very detached from that aspect of religion. Because just like I think what you're saying, if I understand it, is that you think of even any type of brainwashing as being bad, and that religions do it, and that maybe that perhaps even religious people create their own virtual reality. But I read the Bible every day, and I love the Bible, and I'm not doing any of that stuff, so maybe it's not the Bible. All right. Open Lines continues. I love where we started. How are we going to end next on Coast to Coast AM? This is Ian Punnett.
Hey, it's Dean Sharp. You know, with energy costs rising and temps getting warmer and electric vehicles here to stay, I can't believe how many homes still don't have solar. Now, granted, there's a lot of misinformation out there, so my solar company, Sunlux, asked me to clear some of it up. First, solar doesn't cost you money. It saves you money. A lot of money. Second, it doesn't matter where your panels are made. What matters is who makes them. And finally, you hear about some system out there for $29.95, but that is not what is going to end up on your home. You know, it means something to me that all the partners at Sunlux left top-tier positions at other solar companies. Why? To do solar better. It's why Sunlux is an LG and Tesla Platinum contractor. The best systems, the best battery solutions, the best service, the best warranty, and a solar company who is straight with you from day one. Hey, it's time for solar. Get started today at sunlux.com. That's sunlux.com, sunlux.com. CFLB 100-8374.
Mood enhancing, pharmacy grade, stimulating talk.
Wanna be fine?
That doesn't sound like you're gonna be fine.
Wanna be fine?
The Tim Conway Jr. Show.
It sounds like it's her last word.
Weeknights at 6 on KFI.
I literally am thunderstruck here. I am, and this is not easy for me to admit, I'm gonna walk forward.
Bill Handel. Mornings from 6 to 10 on KFI.
Usually I have an answer.
I always have an answer.
Because I know everything.
Because I should be king of the world. Bill Handel.
Can you imagine?
Mornings from 6 to 10 on KFI.
Don't, hey, if you're wasted, what are you doing going?